Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Goodbye Again, Essays, Reflections, and Illustrations by Jonny Sun. This is the author. For my parents, who I've said goodbye to more than anyone else, which I suppose is, in itself, its own kind of blessing. Foreword, a little hello. 2018 was supposed to be the year where I actively got more rest. I had felt burnt out from the relentlessness of the world and from my attempts to retreat into productiveness, to spend all my time focused on something that I knew would bring me stress but in exchange would give me some semblance or illusion of control, in the hopes that I could find some solace in the distractions of always having something I should be working on. All of that led to even deeper burnouts, which led to deeper depressive episodes, which ultimately led to a bargain I made with myself that said I needed to start taking better care of myself if I were to continue to survive. And so 2018 was supposed to be the year where I actively did that. And for a while, I was doing well. I was learning to take breaks and to get rest, not the type of rest that actually just builds more pressure because you feel like you're putting off something you should be doing, but actual, true, healing rest. Then, between quiet moments, I started squirreling away thoughts that I made sure to write down so I wouldn't forget them, collecting ideas and little drawings, hoarding them. I set out trying to be less trapped by the pressure to be constantly productive, and as soon as I started finding those moments where I allowed myself to stop working or thinking about working for a second, to find ways to relax, to recover, to let my mind meander for the sake of it, I decided that I needed to write about them, that I had to document them and collect them, or else I would forget them and lose them. Otherwise, I told myself, all this break-taking, this intentionally unproductive time, would not be worth it. Somewhere, that desire to have some sort of proof that I was taking time off turned into the idea that this needed to be a project, that my time spent not being productive had to have a product in order to be worth doing. This morphed into the thought that I couldn't let this writing just be for myself. There was this constant voice in my head telling me that my own rest and recovery and catharsis were not valuable to anybody, or perhaps more honestly, I thought they were not valuable to myself, unless I could have something to show for it, unless I could share it. Otherwise, I was just being selfish for taking a break, for trying to heal or grow in private. That pressure that I needed something to show for my time, tied to how deeply ingrained I am in our culture of constant work and demand and production and optimization, felt inescapable. I felt, and still feel, trapped inside of it. So instead of taking a break where I could find a little bit of rest, I looked forward to break time because it let me work on something else. From this break-taking, these essays came. A year of trying to take a break became 2 years, then 3 years of writing and putting these pieces together and working on this book. And over those 3 years, working on this book kept me some consistent sort of company as I navigated some destabilizing goodbyes of moving out of different rooms and different apartments and leaving different cities, and then some destabilizing hellos of trying to find ways to live in the new places I landed in. Writing through all of this allowed me some stable way to focus on some feelings, to figure out some of my unspoken habits, and to articulate some things that were important to me. So now I can hold these things in my hand, and I can refer to them in the future, a collection of things I figured out, or things I care about. And this feels like growth, or progress, or maybe I'm just trying to justify this need to work over rest. Maybe it's a little bit of both. These essays are short as an acknowledgement that we're all burned out and we don't have enough time as it is, so I'm just stealing a moment or two from you whenever I'm able to. In the same way I have been stealing moments away, stealing little breaks and stealing from little breaks to write this. I don't want to burden you or ask for much, and I hope you can visit these as you steal moments away for yourself whenever you can, and I hope they offer something to you, and I hope that's enough, and I hope that's all right. Part 1. Goodbye. Moving. Every time I move, my guitar is the last thing I pack. After I move out all the boxes, all the moving supplies, all the furniture, I set aside about 30 minutes to play some songs in my home, or what was my home for so long, now empty. I allow my voice to fill up all its rooms for the last time, in the exact way I choose it to, in the exact way I'd like my voice to be remembered here, in the exact way I'd like to remember it here too. After so many moves, I've learned that this is how I enjoy saying goodbye to a room the most. This time, I am in my now empty basement level, sorry, garden level, as the listing so persuasively described it, apartment. A couple nights ago, I moved my bed to disassemble its frame, and in doing so, I revealed a corner that I had never really looked at before. There was a power outlet there, right behind my head, that I never knew existed. I must have overlooked it when I put my bed in this spot when I first moved in, or maybe, more realistically, I had noticed it when I got here but then forgot about it in the general chaos of trying to fill the empty space. Knowing this power outlet existed right by my head where I slept would have been helpful. I'd been charging my phone from a power outlet by the doorway, far enough away from my bed that if I were already in bed and on my phone at night, I would have to get out of bed and walk over to the power outlet to plug in my phone and then get back into bed, but now without my phone. And this led to a lot of late nights staying awake on my phone because I didn't want to get out of bed to plug in my phone, but I also didn't want to go to sleep without charging it, and so I just did what any sensible person would do, what felt like the compromise, which was to stay on my phone in bed until my phone died, at which point I would get out of bed to charge it because I could no longer be on it. I wanted to get a longer charging cord or an extension cable, but I'd never gotten around to it in the 2 years I had lived here. In this one move of revealing a power outlet that would have saved me so many hours of lost sleep, suddenly this place was strange again, just as strange to me as the first time I saw it, empty and new, when I moved in. I thought by living here, I knew everything about this space. I leave it wishing I'd paid more attention to it. I spent my last night and my first night here sleeping on a mattress on the floor surrounded by boxes. A bed frame was constructed, then deconstructed in the time in between. Living in a place feels like it's bookended by parallel experiences. You move into an empty space feeling uncertain about it, and slowly you let the space hold on to that uncertainty so you don't have to. And when you leave it again as an empty space, taking back the uncertainty that you were storing in it. It ends with an empty room, the same as it began, although you've changed in all the time in between. In my case, the biggest tangible change seemed to be that in my last night here, I plugged my phone into this newly discovered power outlet for the very first time, and I got a slightly better night of sleep than I've had in perhaps the last 2 years. Now, in the morning after, in the last morning that I live here, after I've moved out the mattress and all the boxes and the phone charger, now that all my belongings and my uncertainties no longer have this place to call their home, it feels like there's nowhere left for the dust to hide. There's nothing left to hide the cracks along the walls, the spots of chipped paint that cover up some quick repair work that don't quite exactly match the original color of the room, the gaps where the floor bends down and away from the baseboard to reveal where air and bugs can get in. There's nothing to hide that the light outside doesn't really reach the back of this north-facing, basement-level, sorry, garden-level, apartment. Is it colder now with all my stuff, all that insulation gone too? Or am I imagining that? The windows, squat and small, positioned at my eye level, which is just above where the asphalt from the parking lot outside meets the wall of my unit, are single-paned and framed with wood so that they leak around the edges whenever the snow piled up on the ground outside in the winter or when it rained too hard over the rest of the year. It was always cold. I suppose. Everything echoes here now in this new hollowness. There is nothing left to absorb the sound and nothing left to absorb me, either. Now I'm not part of the space. I just bounce off the walls, echoing until I leave. As I play my guitar here, I jump around from song to song, relishing how these songs I know by heart sound in this new, rare echoing. I've played these songs many times in this room, but it had always been with my stuff around. Now they sound fuller, louder, almost freer. And I'm giving one last chance for the room to hear them, and to hear me, before I go. I hate ending songs when I play, which once made me a terrible performer before I stopped performing at all. Songs with great, beautiful, perfect endings feel too sad for me to play all the way through. I can't face that ending, that feeling of finality, that no more of the song comes after it. Even a song that fades out slowly as if to suggest that its chorus continues looping forever and ever, and it's just that you are growing more and more distant from it, ends with silence. So I play each song I know about halfway through. I stop mid-word, switch over to the beginning of another one, then get as far as the bridge in that next one before I have this voice in my head that suddenly goes, "All right, that's enough." Then whatever chord I played last, mid-phrase, before this thought entered my head, hangs in the air for a second, then disappears. And then, that's it here. That's enough. I suppose that all I hope for is for this home to remember me the way I remember it. Imperfect, quiet, creaking, but always trying to be something better than it is on paper, in person, in memory. And I hope for neither of us to see each other again, lest it breaks the spell. Visiting. You can't outrun sadness because sadness is already everywhere. Sadness isn't the visitor. You are. Filling the blankness. There's a specific type of emptiness in moving to a new place to start a new job or start at a new school and not having a life figured out there yet and not really knowing anyone there yet and being faced with the blank slate openness of Saturday and Sunday and realizing you're just trying to make it through the weekend to get back to having some defined purpose again on Monday. This blankness is one of the scariest things to me. I don't enjoy having time that's been unaccounted for because it immediately makes me feel like I should be doing something with it, and then I can't think of anything that I could possibly be doing that would be worthwhile enough to live up to the raw potential of any amount of available time. Nothing I choose to fill that time with feels like it would be enough. And it makes me sad that the thing that feels closest is taking any time and converting that into some sort of productiveness. I think instead of turning to people or to hobbies or to going places or seeing things, I find it easiest to turn to doing more work to try to fill or perhaps keep at bay that emptiness and that feeling that I can't ever fill that emptiness enough. In the same way that sadness is always there, I find the idea of work and working comforting. It feels like I can leave everything else behind, but as long as I am with myself, I can always work. I can always do something with my time. It is something I can always turn to. This is a learned response. People will forgive you for not doing anything else with your time or for not having any free time at all if you're busy, I tell myself. People will praise you for working more, for finding more time to be productive. Every time I do this, I reinforce this attitude and this lie that work is more important than anything else. And I fall deeper and deeper for it. So on my Saturdays and Sundays, instead of going outside, instead of exploring the city, instead of trying to make friends with the few people I only barely know here, instead of having a weekend, I make up another project for myself. I hole myself up and work and write and catch up on other projects and fill up all the emptiness until I can have a purpose and a fullness defined for me again on Monday. Succulent. Never overwater a succulent to try to get it to grow faster. It will not grow faster. You will drown its roots, and the roots will rot, and then the plant will die. As the older outer leaves grow and get further from the center of the plant, let them dry out and fall away when they are ready to. Do not worry about them. It is natural for what is away from the center of the plant to fall away. It is part of how the plant allocates its resources to survive. With time, new leaves will grow. When they do, they will grow from the center. It will be slow, but if you take time to notice them, every new day will reveal a tiny bit of growth, and over time, that growth will become apparent. To propagate the succulent, you can try to separate one of the healthy leaves at its base, bending it until it separates where it joins the stem, and then setting it out to dry. I've been told that sometimes, with enough time and the right conditions, this separated leaf might scabble.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.